and jump into the program. And before I start, or rather before I hand over to Dr. Mowa, who will be our moderator for today, I would like to thank the people who actually accepted to participate in these different roles. I think everyone is here. That is part of the program. So I thank you all for making the time to be here. And Dr. Mowa, if you can take over with the opening prayer, and then I will get moving.
Let us pray. Father, we thank you for bringing us together as a family after our usual activities during the week. It's refreshing to come before you as brothers and sisters to fellowship together and to hear your word. May we indeed experience a Sabbath rest this evening and tomorrow, because we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
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 I will pull up the program so that you know where we are. Can you see?
Yes.
All right. So we are on number 3. Sorry, I didn't number. So children's story, Sister Ebony Carter. Sister Carter, are you around?
I'm here.
Okay. Please go ahead. I'll stop the showing. I'll come back to it later. And after the children's story, we shall have a special song immediately after the children's story. So let's go to the children's story.
Okay. Today's children's story is the Passover. Exodus 12, chapter 12, verse 3. That night, the king, his officials, all the other Egyptians were awakened. There was loud crying throughout Egypt, because there was not one home which there was not a dead son. God told Moses when he sent the final plague, the Israelites would leave Egypt. That same night, he gave Moses instructions for the Israelites, telling them that they should do to protect their own firstborn sons. Every Israelite family must kill a young male lamb or goat and put some of the blood round the door of their houses. Then they must roast the lamb and eat it with herbs and flat loaves of bread made without yeast. When God comes to bring judgment and sees the sign of blood over your doors, he will pass over your houses and your children will be safe. Moses told the Israelites, at midnight, God passed over every house where he saw the blood, but he struck dead every firstborn Egyptian boy, from the king's own son to the sons of prisoners. When Pharaoh, the king of Egypt, discovered the dead body of his own firstborn, he knew that he had brought this destruction on his country because of his cruelty. Today's song is This Little Light of Mine. This little light of mine. Light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine.
Amen.
Thank you so much, Ebony, for the story and the song.
Beautiful.
You're welcome.
Hey. Thank you. Again, let me just show you, for those who have just come, this is our program. We've just had the children's story and the special song. And so we shall ask our president for Azana, Brother Chiyombwe, to make the announcements, and that will be followed by a health nugget on COVID-19 update from Brother Zulu. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Moore. Thank you to the Carolinas. Thank you to Ebony. She really did a good job. She's packed with talent right there. Praise God for that. Just want to thank everybody who has tuned in today. Starting off to be a wonderful program. The only announcement that I have for next week is that we will have a combined service by Azana and Zawi. End of the year service. Please make sure you attend and invite other people. It will be the end of the year service. So would like to have as many people as we can so that we can praise the Lord together, worship and fellowship together. So next week, we have a combined session, Azana and Zawi. There's plenty. I just want to announce early that it will be a 2-hour program. So let's be ready for 2 hours. It will be packed. It won't be boring. There'll be no idling time. Lots of music, poems, sermons, and everything that you can have. We'll have it next week. Thank you so much. That's the only big announcement that I had this evening.
Thank you so much, Mr. President. We'll have Brother Zulu on Health Nugget. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I was asked to give a 10-minute presentation on COVID-19 vaccines because of what has been happening, the great news out there. So I'll try to be as effective and to simplify terms as much as possible. So as we all know, COVID-19 vaccine is receiving FDA approval. I didn't get the news by the end of the day whether FDA has approved, but as you know, yesterday the panel recommended approval, so maybe by now we have the approval. Meaning that the vaccines have been extensively studied. And
Elder Zulu.
Hello?
Just prop you're just seeing part of your head.
You're seeing part of my head.
Yeah, so if you can make sure that it's right there. Thank you, sir.
I couldn't see myself, so yeah. I think
right there.
You can see me now.
Yes, sir.
Good.
Sorry about that.
No problem. Thanks for letting me. I didn't know that you are just seeing part of my head. So let's see if I can get back to where I was. Yeah, so I was saying that. Okay. Can you still see me?
Yes.
Okay, good. Yeah, so now you've heard, I've tried to touch some of the things that you should have heard about and probably causing controversy, but like, for example, the fact that COVID-19 vaccines have used new technology using what we call messenger RNA. So what is RNA? It is a substance that is present in all living cells in our bodies. Its principal role is to act as a messenger, carrying instructions from the DNA, and DNA is really the center of activity of in our cells that gives the information of who we are, how the body should act, what proteins produce. So it's really a complex center. So it carries instructions from DNA for controlling the manufacture of various substances, various proteins in the body. Now, to trigger an immune response, many vaccines that we have had so far use a weakened form or a killed germ or virus that is introduced in our bodies. Now, instead of a weakened or killed germ, COVID vaccines are using this substance, messenger RNA. Now, messenger RNA vaccines teach our cells or our bodies how to make a protein, or even just a piece of a protein that triggers an immune response inside our bodies without putting any germ into the body, like the way things were done previously. So the body produces an immune response, which produces antibodies. And the antibodies is what protects us from getting infected if a real virus enters our bodies. Now, mRNA or messenger RNA never enters the nucleus of the cells, which is where our DNA is kept to do this. The messenger RNA tricks the body to think that there's a germ, in this case, a COVID-19 virus, when in actual sense, there's no virus. Therefore, the body reacts to produce antibodies against COVID-19 virus. Thereafter, the body breaks down and gets rid of the messenger RNA soon after it has finished using the instructions from the messenger RNA. And at the end of the process, our bodies have learned how to protect against future infections, so that when there is an infection, the body has been primed already and will quickly produce antibodies to protect us. Now, the benefit of messenger RNA or mRNA vaccines is that those vaccinated gain this protection without ever having to risk the serious consequences of getting sick with COVID-19. COVID-19 vaccines are the first authorized messenger RNA vaccines in the United States and probably in the world. But researchers have been studying these mRNA vaccines for decades. And interest has grown in these vaccines because they can be developed in a laboratory using readily available material. This means the process can be standardized across labs and scaled up, making vaccine development faster than the traditional methods of making vaccines, which really took long to make. Now, mRNA vaccines have been studied before for flus, Zika virus, rabies, and other viruses. Now, because there's been before, as soon as the necessary information about the virus that causes COVID-19 was available, scientists began designing the mRNA instructions for cells to build the unique protein into an mRNA vaccine. In fact, like for Moderna, it is said that they designed this vaccine in just over a weekend. Now, future mRNA vaccine technology may allow for one vaccine provide protection for multiple diseases, thus decreasing the number of shots needed for protection against common vaccine preventable diseases. Now, beyond viruses, cancer research has used mRNA to trigger the immune system to target specific cancer cells, because you know that cancer cells also benefit from antibodies. Now, having laid that, let me go to Pedro Drug Administration. We have all heard a lot about FDA in this past week, and even in the many weeks or months before this. Now, this is the body responsible for regulation of vaccine safety, effectiveness, and quality. FDA is globally respected for its scientific standards of vaccine safety, effectiveness, and quality. The agency provides scientific and regulatory advice to vaccine developers and undertakes a rigorous evaluation of the scientific information through all phases of clinical trials, which continues even after a vaccine has been developed and has been approved by FDA or authorized for emergency use. Now, FDA recognizes the gravity of the current public health emergency, the COVID emergency, and the importance of facilitating availability as soon as possible of vaccines to prevent COVID-19 infections, and that the public will trust and have confidence in receiving. Now, FDA staff are career scientists and physicians who have globally recognized expertise in the complexity of vaccine development and in evaluating the safety and effectiveness of all vaccines intended to prevent infectious diseases. FDA professionals are committed to decision-making based on scientifically driven evaluation of data. I think you've been really following this, how the science has been critiqued, the data has been looked at for safety. So FDA is at the center of that. And also to remember that FDA are like your family. They are fathers, they are mothers, they are daughters, they are sons, sisters, brothers, and many more. And they and their families are also directly impacted by the work that they do and are exactly who you want making these important public health decisions for the United States. So many times, I think you've seen videos where people say, they are doing this, you know? So many times I say, who are they? But not just to make sure that, to emphasize that the people regulating this are people, you know, who are like us, brothers, sisters, wives, husbands. So in addition, FDA engages independent external experts to advise on decisions FDA should make on vaccine approval. Yesterday was a good example. There was the FDA advisory panel that sat the whole day, actually. And these were experts from different institutions, you know, not employed by FDA, independent and not paid by FDA, to look at the data, what the data said in terms of safety, efficacy, and everything. And finally, they make the approval. Now, many times you hear stories of, no, this vaccine, we shouldn't have vaccines, whatever. So the question, I borrowed this question from Dr. Mdende. What does a world without vaccines look like? I would say exactly what it is today. With 3,000 deaths per day and thousands of hospitalized patients and thousands of new infections every day, with people living in perpetual fear of what would happen next. A world without vaccines also means a world with restricted lives as it is today, limited travel, limited business transactions, and frequent shutdowns of businesses or schools. Can we live without in that kind of world? I don't know, maybe we can, but we are failing to mask and do all those things. So going back to, I'll be concluding shortly. So how was it possible to develop a vaccine so quickly? You know, there's continuous ongoing research on vaccines. Therefore, there's preparedness, there's knowledge developing all the time. And on top of, in addition to the continuous research, the US government put together government agencies, international experts, academia, nonprofit organizations, pharmaceutical companies to develop a coordinated strategy for prioritizing, and spreading and speeding development of the most promising vaccines. In addition, the federal government made investments in the necessary manufacturing capacity at its own risk. They gave these drug companies a lot of money. You know, usually to develop, it takes a lot of money, and the drug companies have to come up with that money. But in this situation, the US government put in the money so that the drug companies can quickly work on it to develop this vaccine. Now, we have the results that we have now. But just to mention that efforts to speed vaccine development to address the ongoing COVID-19 pandemic have not sacrificed scientific standards, integrity of the vaccine process or safety. The current vaccine that is under consideration this week is the Pfizer vaccine with an efficacy of 95%. Clinical trials involved 45,000 people and requires two doses given 3 weeks apart. The vaccine was tested on thousands of people during August, September, with no serious side effects reported. It was first approved in the United Kingdom and it has been approved in Canada by all, and these are all independent bodies looking at this. The vaccine's ability to prevent infections in children, pregnant women, or immunocompromised people, and its duration of immune effect are still unknown. Distribution and storage, as we all know, minus 70, so that makes it very challenging to easily distribute. Side effects, the non-side effects are fever, fatigue, chills, redness, and swelling, but there have been no deaths in the people vaccinated so far. So, and as I said, having looked at all this by independent groups, independent scientists, this vaccine has been shown to be safe for use in humans and hence the approval. And we think by next week, the immunizations will happen. And sometimes people ask me, so are you going to get vaccinated to accept the vaccination? The answer is yes. Once it's available, I will be among the people vaccinated. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
While you are talking, the news is that Pfizer has been approved for use now.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Brother Isaac. For those of you who may not know Brother Isaac, he works for the CDC, the agency that's responsible for protecting America, the US. So, and he's in the front lines. He's in the front lines of COVID-19. So we're fortunate to have him in our group. We shall have a prayer requests, time for prayers, and Sister Malala Simons will lead us. And then after that, we shall have a special song by Sister Priscilla Boeing. Over to you, Sister Malala.
Yes, thank you. Do we have anyone with a special prayer request?
Yes.
Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am, we did.
Okay, all right.
Let me be the first one. As you know, some of you know, probably most, have been battling COVID the past 1 week. And today is the first day that really I've been up and appetite is slowly coming. So I'm thankful.
Amen to that.
This is a different animal, but God is good. I am really thankful.
Amen.
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 And if you don't mind, as you come on with a prayer request, may I please have your names?
Oh, Chongo Mundende.
Thank you. Do we have another prayer request?
Yes, I do. My name is Marjorie, for my cousin Carol. She has stomach cancer, and at the hospital, they told her that there's nothing they can do, so they would discharge her from home. So she's just having episodes of highs and lows. Her name is Carol.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Do we have anyone?
Yeah, a prayer of thanks. This is in Tani.
Okay, I'm going to think this is all we have for the prayer request. Let us pray. God, you are a divine physician and a healer of the sick. We turn to you in this time of illness, oh dearest Father of the troubled. Father, we thank you for our brother who is recovering from COVID. And we're praying for Sister Carol. As you are the gracious physician, Lord, you know our sorrows. With your gentle love and grant us grace and strength to accept this burden, God. God, we place our worries in your hands, Father. We lift all those who are facing illnesses today. We ask that you would bring healing, comfort, and peace in their bodies, Lord. Calm their fears and let them experience the healing power of your love, oh God. Father, we thank you for answering our prayers through Brother Ntani. We appreciate, Lord, all you do for us. I know, God, we are sinners, not worth mentioning your names. Teach us to trust in you, Lord, so that when the unexpected storms of life come, we will expect in the midst of the storms to survive and thrive, knowing that you are in our, you hear our cries and you are with us all the time. Right now, Lord, we ask to speak of the roots of fear, guilt, shame, and condemnation. We are forgiven in your sight, Lord. We denounce the lies of the enemy that accuse us of not being right. Father, we ask for forgiveness. We pray for the whole nation, Lord. Through the calamity that is going on, we pray for all the people, the first responders, people in the medical field, those that are still recovering, Lord, give them strength. Father, we pray that as we go to sleep tonight, you be our protector. Tomorrow is not promised, but you know what tomorrow is gonna be like, God. Father, be at the center of everything in our lives, because without you, we are off balance and spinning out of control, Father. Help us fight against the evil spirits of the world. We pray that every demonic force brought against us will not prevail. We will survive and thrive every attack against our health, our finances, and relationships. Father, you know your will. We are here to receive all the blessings that we can get from you, Lord. We ask and pray through the name of Jesus Christ. And Lord, we thank you for this fellowship and pray that it may continue. We ask and pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Sister Malala.
You're welcome.
Sister Priscilla, are you ready to bless us with a song?
Yes, I am.
Please go ahead, and after Sister Priscilla's song, we shall have the preacher today, tonight is Brother Chris Carter. So immediately after the song, our speaker will bless us.
I was just a child when I felt the Savior leading. I was drawn to what I could not understand. And for the cause of Christ, I have spent my days believing that what he'd have me be is who I am. As I've come to see the weaker side of me, I realized his grace is what I'll need. When sin demanded justice for my soul, mercy said no, I'm not gonna let you go. I'm not gonna let you slip away. You don't have to be afraid. Mercy said no. Sin will never take control, oh no. Life and death stood face to face. Darkness tried to steal my heart away. Thank you, Jesus. Mercy said no. For God so loved the world that he sent his son to save us. From the cross he built a bridge to set us free. Oh, but deep within our hearts, there is still a war that wages and makes a sacrifice so hard to see. Oh, as midnight fell on crucifixion day, the light of hope seemed oh so far away. As evil tried to stop redemption's flow, mercy said no. I'm not gonna let you go. I'm not gonna let you slip away. You don't have to be afraid. Mercy said no. Sin will never take control, oh no. Life and death stood face to face. Darkness tried to steal my heart away. Thank you, Jesus. Mercy said no. And now when heaven looks at me, it's through the blood of Jesus, reminding me of one day long ago. Mercy said no, I'm not gonna let you go. I'm not gonna let you slip away. You don't have to be afraid. Mercy said no, sin will never take control, oh no. Life and death stood face to face. Darkness tried to steal my heart away. Thank you, Jesus. Mercy said no. Mercy said no.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen.
Ricardo, you go ahead.
Okay. Shabbat Shalom for those who are within the realms of sunset. I understand that this group can possibly transcend borders and therefore certain utterances of the Bible were tied to the physical Jerusalem and certain was international, but we still say Shabbat Shalom if it is with you or you're within the Sabbath, or if it's not yet, when it comes, please have a complete Sabbath. Okay, today we'll be looking at, I'm gonna try not to preach. I've been preaching all my 20 something years of life in spirituality. And I'm trying now not to preach so much, but to teach, because in the time that we've come to live, there is a strategy that the devil uses that many times cannot be overcome in a pulpit or in a preaching mode, because he, for instance, if he wants to attack someone in the black community and he names the warship black, whatever, and then if you retaliate against that ship, you'll be looked upon as retaliating against black people. So he mixes stuff together to create the impression, the illusion of one thing when another is happening. And then if you're in a preaching mode, you may say something that is not fully explained, and then guess what? Someone leaves with the wrong understanding because you just didn't have the time or the mode of presentation didn't allow for that. So I'll try today to teach and try to compress it. As my wife normally tells me, I try to put too much information in one message. So I'm going to compress it. So I'm going to be presenting from a PowerPoint today, which is different for me, because normally I can't wait on the PowerPoint. So I'm preaching and I'm moving. So I guess the PowerPoint today will kind of slow me down so that I can present. So today the message will be, I'll present it from I don't know if you're seeing the screen now. Are you seeing it?
Yes.
Okay, so the mark or the seal. A very well spoken about, almost all denominations carry some versions of the mark of the beast, because almost all persons today claim to be prophets, even when Yah had never sent them. And I will remind us of the text in Isaiah 8:20 that applies to all who would speak in the name of Yahuwah, Elohim. That he spoke through Isaiah when he said, to the law and to the testimony, if they speak not according to this word, it is because there is no light in them. The Hebrew says to the instructions, because the word law gives a legal, aura, it gives a legal feeling. But if you look at the Hebrew root, it's actually instructions, and it's meant to give you the impression of a father teaching a child how to do something. That child messes up and he picks him up, he brushes him off, and he said, okay, here's how you do it better next time. That's what Torah, that's what the law, as we know it, but the instructions are meant to do. So that as a backdrop. So many people speak about the mark of the beast and have many different arguments for and against. And just like someone who is trained in detecting counterfeit, I was told earlier in my life that those who do that don't try to find every counterfeit to look at, but they study the real thing. And they will know when it's not real. So in order to understand the import and the impact of the mark, you must study the seal, not the mark in and of itself, but the seal. So we will go forward. We'll read in Revelation 13, 11 to 17, and I beheld another beast coming up out of the earth, and he had two horns like a lamb, and he spake as a dragon, and he exercised all the power of the first beast before him, and causeth the earth and them which dwell therein to worship the first beast whose deadly wound was healed. And he doeth great wonders, so that he maketh fire to come down from heaven on the earth in the sight of men. And heaven here doesn't mean heaven of heavens. Heavens here in the Hebrew would be Shamayim, which means above. So it's not coming down from Yah or from God. It's coming down from above. And he deceived them that dwell on the earth by the means of those miracles which he had power to do in the sight of the beast, saying to them that dwell on the earth that they should make an image to the beast which had the wound by a sword and did live. And he had power to give life unto the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and cause as many as would not worship the image of the beast should be killed. And he causes all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their hand or in their foreheads. Now, we want to identify firstly the beast, some characteristics of the beast. And we're going to move into that, as I'm saying, I want to keep it concise. The beast in the Bible, as we all know, a beast is a kingdom, horns represent kings, sea represent people, land or ares in Hebrew represents earth, a sparsely populated place. Moving right along. Therefore, the beast had two horns, kings like a lamb, not a lamb-like beast. Let me pause here to give you the difference in theology, well, not theology, because it's not the study of God, but in reasoning behind these two definitions. The Bible says two horns like a lamb, the popular saying the lamb-like beast. The reasoning behind the lamb-like beast is that the beast is calm and Christ-like for a season and will at some point become aggressive. That's not what the Bible says. We just read it. The Bible says that he spake as a dragon. In Hebrew, if something is described, the function of that thing is described, not the appearance. Hence, when Christ said to the people, you are whitewashed sepulchres, because you appear all shiny on the outside, but you're rotting on the inside. What he was specifically saying, that your function is not what you ought to be, but you have a good appearance. Hebrews, if something is not functioning as a fig tree, it's considered bad or evil. So when Christ came to the fig tree and it was not bearing fruit at a time when it should, and it did not function as it should, he cursed it. That's a typical Hebrew response. Anything that is not functional, if you have a cordless drill and it just doesn't function, you're going to either fix it or throw it out because it does not function. So for the Hebrew, it's a functionality over form. So here, when the Bible says that the beast had two horns like a lamb, but he spake as a dragon, the voice of the person or the thing is a character. For instance, Christ said that which cometh out of the mouth cometh out of the abundance of the heart, and it is the thing that comes out of you that defiles you. Not saying that you should eat anything. That's not what he was saying, but he's saying that it is thing that comes out of you, the function. So your voice speaks to your character. So the lamb-like beast, or the beast that we call the lamb-like beast, is really not a lamb-like beast and will not somehow in the future become an aggressive beast. No. In fact, before America was considered as a nation, they were buying and selling slaves. And in Revelation 18, the beast described as Babylon, which encompasses all, mentions that this beast buys and sells slaves. So this power was acting as the beast from the beginning, just as the Bible says that it exercised all the power of the beast before, and caused as many that would not worship the beast to be killed. Now, understand here, we're going to define worship further on, because you may be looking at worship here and thinking that that's not happening, but you'll be surprised to know that it's happening. So it speaks as a dragon. It exercises all the power of the beast before it. It bought and sold the slave. It shed the blood of Yah's elect. And that's an important criteria in Revelation further down, when it states that he's going to punish. In fact, after the third plague, when the rivers were turned into blood, the angel said to them, give them blood to drink because they have shed the blood of saints. So it's an important thing to Yahuwah that the blood of his saints are shed. And saints here doesn't give the same understanding of sainthood in the Catholic Church. It's a whole different thing. It's actually an elect. It's a set apart. It's a sanctified person. Okay, so let's move on. Qualifying for the mark. What do you do to qualify for the mark? It sounds like a race, right? Webster's dictionary defines worship as the reverent love and devotion accorded to a deity, an idol, or a sacred object. The ceremonies, prayers, or other religious forms which this love is expressed, by which this love is expressed. So that's Webster's definition of worship. Remember that the person speaking here is the author of the Hebrew race. He's the author of the Hebrew language. In fact, he's the author of written language, because both Greek, Latin, and what we have today came from Hebrew. All of them came from Hebrew. Therefore, he's the author of language. We're not even talking about author of the world or creator of the world. We're just talking about language for this presentation. So we have to now go back to see what he means when he says worship. Is he saying the same thing as Webster's dictionary? Let's go on. Hebrew definition of worship simply means to bow down. Shahar. You see, it spells with a shin, he, and het. We will not go into that right now, but it simply means to bow down. So when Adonijah bowed to Solomon after his transgression, it's the same word that is used for worship elsewhere in the 170+ times that word is used throughout the Bible. When Moshe went to meet his father-in-law, and the Bible says that he paid obeisance, it's the same word for worship. It's bow down. This now puts the definition of revelation into a whole new light. Because it means that once you bow down to something or hand over authority to someone, you're in a position of worship. Sounds outlandish, but that's it. So what we're seeing now, the question my son asked me is that, didn't Yah say that we should honor the leaders that are put up above us? I said, yes, in as far as it does not contravene Torah. Just as Isaiah says, to the law and to the testimony. So in as far as it does not contravene Torah, you can obey them. But when it comes to that point, you have to make a decision. Just as the Hebrew boys did, they said, King, we respect you, but at this point, we're going to have to make a slight adjustment to your understanding of how far we will go with you. And they did, and Yah stood up for them mightily. So once you bow down, the Bible has all that as worship. The defining factor in that is this. Where is that person leading? What's the function of that bowing down? Remember, we said that Hebrews look at function, not form, not all the rituals, all the feast days. It's a function, not the form. The world today is focused on the forms of things, but it's a function. So we move on to putting this in the text, Revelation 13, verse 4. And they worshiped the dragon, which gave power unto the beast, and they worshiped the beast, saying, who is like unto the beast, who is able to make war with him? Notice this has no religious significant connotations when you put it in the next. When you translate to the concrete Hebrew, and they bowed down to the dragon, which gave power unto the beast, and they bowed down to the beast, saying, who is like unto the beast? Who is able to make war with him? Notice a trend here with the beast before this present beast. It was always a political power enacting religious laws. And so people had a trend of following a political power, mostly. And here they bowed down to him, basically saying, not on their faces, but they basically said, look, no one can make war with you. So you are the superpower. You rule the world. We give all our respect to you. The defining issue here is, where does that take you? Because the Bible, Yah does not look at things of the seed sprouting in the earth before it comes up. Yah look at the function of that seed when it is grown as a full tree. And that is why he says, shun the very appearance of evil, because he sees the function of it, while the devil gives you the illusion that this is so simple now. Yah sees the very end and knows how catastrophic it is to you in the long run. So Yah says, shun it. So we move on now to the conditions of the seal, because as I said, our focus is not on the mark. The mark, for instance, the Bible says that the plague will be poured out on all that does not have the seal of God. And the Bible says that all whose names are not in the Lamb's Book of Life will receive the mark. It means then that there's one camp or the other. And for the many different cultures you can think of in the world who does not worship in anywhere remotely like we do in the Western world, yet will be classified in this, then it makes you understand that the mark or the leading things that leads up to the mark cannot be any single thing. In fact, anyone who does not walk with Yah is considered to have the mark. At that point, anyone who is not in the camp of Yah is in the camp of the mark. and will receive the same punishment. Therefore, it's not a specific thing in and of itself, just like counterfeit that comes in many different forms, on many different paper, different kind of ink. The only thing that is constant in all of this is the seal of Yahuwah, Torah. Let's move on. And I saw another angel ascending from the east, having the seal of the living God, and he cried with a loud voice to the four angels, to whom it was given to hurt the earth and the sea, and saying, hurt not the earth, neither the sea, nor the trees, till we have sealed the servants of our God in their foreheads. And I heard the number of them which were sealed, and there were sealed 144,000 of all the tribes of the children of Israel. Let's go back to that. Let me kind of clear that up just a little bit for you. The 144,000 Israelites, without going into the numbers and the significance of that, that the Bible speaks of here, some may call it symbolic, but if you look at the events before and the events after, then you realize it's not symbolic. These are real people. Just as the number that is without number that comes after is not symbolic, otherwise we would be hoping in vain. The 144,000 is not symbolic. Why did Yah bring up that in the last? Because from the beginning, Yah says, I'm gonna establish a nation, and through that nation, I will reach the rest of humanity to bring them back to me. The devil says, oh, that's not gonna work because they are feeble humans, and I'm gonna show that to you. Not in so many words, but we know that we through Bible, we can point to the point times when Yehoshua was standing before Yah and the devil accused them. We know that story. We know that the devil is called the accuser of the brethren. We know all that. When the Mashiach came, Christ, he says, I am come not but to the lost house of Israel. Shaul, Paul, says that the message came to us first. First here, again, Western think linear. Hebrew does not think that way. In Western world, we said first, and you lost your chance, you blew it, you're out. Next. That's not how Yah sees it. Yah says, it's going to go to you first, then from you to the rest of the world, just as I designed it. And when you read Revelation, you will understand that all the things that Yah said that he's doing and that will come in the New Jerusalem are the things that he did in the Garden of Eden and was usurped. And he said, look, I'm going to do it. And if Yah had to abort any of those plans because of the devil, he would have lost. But because he's God and none like him, none beside him, none before him, none after him, he says, I'm going to do it. So he shows the devil at the very last stage of history, the very last moment of history, here is 144,000 who did not follow you, to show you that the laws that I put in place when I gave you Torah, gave them Torah, it was not a hard thing to do. And if you look at the laws, you'll realize it's more for us. If you rest one day out of the week, honestly, you're not doing God any favor, honestly. Because if you should work 24/7, you're going to expire real quick. If you do not steal, it benefits you. If you do not covet, it benefits you. So everything that he tells us, and of course, a commandment is the face of the law, the face of Torah. It is the ratification of the covenant. It is holy, it is just, it is true, but it's not Torah. It is not the law. Because Moshe says, read Torah so that you will know how to keep the commandments. Plain and simple. So what you understand is that Yahuwah he gives us the law for our benefit, really for our benefit. So he says to the devil, here is a group that did not follow you. And here's another multitude that follow you, but because the blood that ratified the covenant, that is the power and strength of the covenant, is able to reach unto the uttermost. These were able to be forgiven, even though they messed up. And that's a number that no man could number, which comes side and side. And so we understand that if this number, if the 144,000 is symbolic, this number is also symbolic, because the only difference between the two is that the Bible says that they were without guile. That's the only difference. And of course, holiness, again, is different from what we conceptualize it. Holiness in the Hebrew means set apart, sanctified. And the Bible tells us that once you walk in Torah, it is your righteousness. You are set apart. And that's where the Ruach HaKodesh comes in. So, holiness is not being God. No, it is not. So when people tell you that this number could not be without guile, wrong. Yah says they were without guile, and that's what I believe. They will be without guile. Okay, let's move on. So the seal, the Greek term is spragizo, to seal. It signifies ownership and the full security carried by the backing, full authority of the owner. Sealing in the ancient world served as a legal signature which guaranteed the promise of what was sealed. Therefore, the king's seal guarantees that whatever is in that document or in that package or whatever is coming from the king. And in Persia, it's irreversible. You can't change it. So, of course, when you look at seal, kafam, in Hebrew, it has three Hebrew letters. Aleph, which is the first letter. Tav, which is the last. Mem is, I don't remember the number letter now, but it is one of the letters. It is the middle letter, I think. No, anyway. So you find that Aleph means power, strength. Tav, mark, sign, signal, and some people say covenant. Mem, movement, water, blood. Now, if you start to see the seal of Yah now through power and strength, the Aleph represents Yahuwah in the Hebrew alphabet. It means power and strength. That's where you get Elohim from. Aleph and Lamed together. Lamed is another letter. Spells El, which means Elohim, which is spelling for Elohim, which means strong leader, which is Yahuwah. So the Aleph represents Yah. So in the seal, we immediately see Yahuwah's name up front. Immediately we see his name up front. Then we have the Tav, which is a covenant. Now you see why the 144,000 is brought up again, because the 144,000 represents the covenant that was promised to Abraham, that was ratified at the mount when the commandment was given. And that is why we have the trump of God and the voice of the archangel at the end, because it began with a trumpet at the mount that sounded long and louder, being blown by beings from the Shamayim, from heaven. Now, that is why you start to see now the covenant, you start to see Yahuwah, and then you start to see the blood in the seal. Therefore, now we can come to a conclusion, even before we end, that the mark of the beast, and the seal of God are states of mind. It's not any one thing or any whatever. It is a state of mind, as we will see eventually. So let's move on from that. I hope I'm not moving too fast. Deuteronomy 6 verse 4. Here is where Yah says, okay, tell you what. Moshe, you're going to die. You're not going to see the promised land, but you're going to counsel these people. That takes love. I can tell you that. He knows that the closer he drew to Canaan is the closer to his death, because he's not going to see Canaan. And he knew that. So here was Moses' parting words. Deathbed, if you wish, though his strength did not diminish. But last words. Hear, O Israel, Yahuwah your Elohim is one. And thou shalt love Yahuwah your Elohim with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might. And these words which I command thee this day shall be in thine heart. Mark the word heart. Because, anyway, let's not go there. I'm trying not to preach. I'm trying not to go too deep. And thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children, and shalt talk of them when thou risest, when thou sittest in thy house, and when thou walkest by the way, and when thou liest down, and when thou risest up. He was talking about Torah here. He mentioned the statutes, commandments, precepts. If you read before, you'll see that. And thou shalt bind them for a sign upon thy hand, and they shall be as frontlets between thine eyes. So we are looking at first mentions now. This is not the first time, but we are looking at close to the first mention. So here, in regards to revelation and the seal in your forehead, here Yahuwah tell you what will be in your forehead or in your mind. Torah. Plain. Clear, clear, clear. And it shall be, when we get to 25, here's what Moshe said to them, and it shall be our righteousness if we observe to do all the commandment before Yahuwah or Elohim as he has commanded us. The word commandment here is not referring to the Decalogue. The word command here is referring to a direct order from a superior. So all that Yah commanded them to do, including not lending your brother money with usury or with interest, or not eating meat with the fat, we understand what that's doing to people these days, but Yah told us that long ago. Don't eat the meat with the fat. It was simple. It was for our benefit. So here Moshe says that it shall be our righteousness. For those who think that, saying that, okay, by doing the commandments, you cannot be righteous. You cannot be saved, but you can be righteous. Yahuwah manifestation in the HaMashiach is who saves us, our kinsman redeemer. That's where salvation comes from. But a lawyer cannot go before a judge to argue in favor of you if you're still committing murder. You would nullify the argument of the lawyer. So while grace, again, which is a misunderstood term, grace is a place of refuge. It is mercy that keeps us alive long enough so that we can enter the place of refuge, but some of us never do. As Hebrew says that we never enter the rest. However, that's all another thing. I don't want to diverge. So here we find that Moshe is saying it is our righteousness. And Yahuwah will reward us for walking in his ways. Now, as we look at the mark, the seal, we realize that if you are not walking in Torah, as Isaiah says to the law and the testimony, it doesn't matter where you are, you're walking in the land of the beast. Now, there will be a time, you can always switch back and forth, no. But there will be a time when the Bible says, he that is unjust, let him be unjust still. He that is filled, let him be filled still. Now, understand this about the beast. Going back to the beast, it had two horns like a lamb. Most people don't realize that the Bible says, in this political climate, that the Bible says that both horns are going to burn with the beast. Most people don't realize that. It didn't say one horn is going to go to heaven and one horn is going to go. It said both, the beast is going to be burnt. It didn't say an exception. The point I'm making here is that I've heard people make some compromise for one political party or the other in recent times, that I said, do we realize what we're doing? Do we realize that it's coming to a point where in one party you cannot ascend to the highest position unless you hate some people? And in the other party, you cannot ascend to the highest position unless you hate some people too? Because one is going to shoot you and one is going to kill your babies. That's the truth. You cannot ascend to the pinnacle of this party unless you agree on certain things, and all of those things you disagree with. So I'm saying to us that we need to be careful of how we follow. Now is the time when the Bible is saying, come out of her, my people. Because we tend to follow the things and rationalize the things. And if we go back to the bow down now. So to worship the beast doesn't mean you need to go sit in a temple somewhere. It just means that you follow the beast. And you rationalize the wrong that the beast does. So guess what? A whole lot of people are worshiping the beast. Already, not even knowing. As if we think the devil is going to come to us and say, oh, here I am, I'm the devil. Let's do this. No, he's not going to do that. He's going to bring an illusion to you. In fact, Yahuwah said that many, notice in the Bible that Yahuwah says that his contention, when the HaMashiach was speaking, he said that, look, he didn't even talk about the people who doesn't even like him. He says that many will come in my name saying that I am. Many will come to me so that, haven't we done this in your name? It tells you that the devil is going to come in a Christ-like manner using the name of the HaMashiach when he's doing something totally different. And for 99.999% of religious worship today, sorry to say, does the very same thing. While the HaMashiach says to you in right down to the last, it says, blessed are they that do the commandments, that they may have the right to enter into the city. Right? That's what he said. He's saying, blessed are they that walk in Torah. He said, think not that I've come to destroy the instructions or the prophets, law and the prophets. I'm not come to destroy, but to fulfill. What he was saying is that our whole being must be walking in Torah. And believe it or not, if you are here just doing it out of form and not function, and it's not in your heart, what's going to happen when the time comes? Christ says that because the word was not planted in you, many will be offended and will run and persecute their own brothers. So when the word is not embedded in you, as Moshe said in Deuteronomy, when you rise up, when you're sitting down, when you're walking, let it be frontlets between your eyes and a sign up on your hand. You were saying, look here, let this be embedded in you. And that is what Yahuwah will see. My daughter used a story that I didn't even know she was going to tell that story as I close. When the seal was upon the doorpost, when we were about to be delivered, and I'm saying we here deliberately, from Egypt. If you are a bloodline Hebrew and the seal was on the door, the blood, that's a seal there. And you came out of the house, which is a het in the covenant, in the seal. If you came out of that wall of protection, if you move beyond that, you're in a secular, according to Hebrew. You're in a secular position. If one of those Hebrews would come out of that building, they would not be protected anymore. Even though the blood is applied to the lintel, if they came out of that fold, in other words, what I'm saying, if we walk out of the prescribed fold of Yahuwah, then we are not protected. Then when we think we stand, we will fall. As night follows day, we will fall. If you are in the habit of saying that the law is no longer necessary, and people who say that don't even have never read it, honestly, because the essence of the law is love to God and your fellow men. That's the essence of it. Every time Yah is going to charge, Israel said that there's blood in your streets. There's no justice for the poor. The Hamashiach says, the Lord, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me and he has anointed me to preach what? Good tidings to the poor. The opening of doors to them that are bound. So, and James put it this way, pure and undefiled religion is this, that thou do justice, love mercy, and walk humbly with thy God. So every time you look at the Bible from Genesis to Revelation, every single one of the apostles quoted Torah extensively. In fact, that's the only thing they had to teach from. The Bible as we know it was not in existence. They only had the Tanakh and Torah, which Christ called the law and the prophets. So as we close, let's not focus on what are any single one of the many things that can lead us to accept the mark, including rationalizing and making excuses for politicians, but focus on what Yahuwah, what Moses says is our righteousness, and that is making sure Torah is embedded in our hearts. And that's it. Once you're in the sealing company, you cannot receive the mark. But once you're not in the sealing company, you could as well have the mark already. And remember that Torah is Genesis to Deuteronomy, upon which every single prophet, every single apostle stands. Have a wonderful Sabbath. Let me.
Amen. Brother Chris, you can go ahead and close in prayer.
Yahuwah, our Father, our King, our Creator and Sustainer, we thank you for your Holy Spirit, the Ruach HaKodesh, that empowers us to walk in Torah, to love you with all our hearts, and to love our neighbors as ourselves, and to stay away from pagan feast days and festivals, to stay away from the things that our society have now made normal and simple, the things that hurt you, the things that you look upon as despicable, but yet we have come to a society that have made those normal. Sodomy lifestyle, killing of our babies, kidnapping of children, all these, Torah says is punishable by death, yet they have become commonplace among us. Help us to be in the world, but not of the world, to come away from these Babylonian behaviors. Help us to walk in you so that you can seal us, so that we do not fall for the mark, but we will stand in your seal, having been redeemed, paid for, bought with the price of your blood. We thank you in Yeshua's name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you all for coming. I hope you've been blessed by the message and the program. I just want to indulge myself just a few minutes. If I won't get in trouble from Elder Mundende.
Go ahead, Elder.
I would like, and if Brother Zulu, if you don't mind, since the issue of vaccines is such a, there's so much conspiracy theory, could I have three questions from the three questions for Dr. Zulu? If you don't have questions for him, that's fine as well.
You can unmute yourselves.
You can unmute yourselves. It's such a hot topic, and I've seen conspiracies on some of the WhatsApp group that I belong to, and I can't believe some of them. So this is a good opportunity. Like I said, Brother Zulu works for CDC and he's in the front lines of COVID. So this will be a good time to ask him questions on vaccine. I'll only allow three questions. Okay, I guess.
No, there should be a lot of questions there. And,
yeah.
I also see videos being shared and a lot of comments. So if there's anything you'd like to say. Or
this, is time. This is your time. We have an expert in our midst. We are so fortunate. You don't have to get it from the street. There's a lot of noise in the street.
Dr. Moa, perhaps Dr. Zulu may shed a little bit more light. I think some of the conspiracies that I've also seen, and I think you may have already touched on this, but it's good to give a little bit more reassurance. What I've heard and some people actually are afraid of, they think like, well, the vaccine is like another way that the government is trying to put some type of electronics in them so they can track them and stuff like that. That's actually causing, unfortunately, even some young people thinking that I'm not going to take it if it becomes available because I don't want to be tracked by the government or be controlled and stuff like that. But that's like one of the conspiracy theory that has been going there and people have been using that as an excuse. So perhaps Dr. Zulu can shed more light on that if there are no questions from the members here.
Yeah, Dr. Zulu, go ahead. And there's a question on the chat. You can see the question on the chat after you've answered Brother Chola's question.
Yeah, okay, so that's two. Yeah, so yeah, I've heard of all these conspiracies. Now government is trying to use vaccines to control COVID vaccines to control, really, that's not the intention. One thing I keep saying is, if that was the intention, then we should have been controlled a long time ago because the vaccines have always been there. You know, think of measles vaccines, polio vaccines, hepatitis B vaccines, all those vaccines have always existed. And I keep talking of flu vaccine, if it was for control, probably flu vaccine would be the perfect, because every year we have to get flu shots. So if there was such a thing, then that could have happened already. And I know that people sometimes use, they say, no, vaccines are for 666, mark of the beast. Really, I keep saying also that, you know, vaccines wouldn't be the perfect vehicle for mark of the beast if it was, if there's such a thing, because not everybody gets vaccines. If the mark of a beast would be to target everybody, so you would want to use something that everybody will have access to, you know. So really, and you know, the nature of the world now is that anything that have anything, people bring up conspiracy theories. As I said earlier, you know, for this, it means this conspiracy should be something that everybody, you know, the people dealing with vaccines, it's not just the American government, you know, it's governments across the world, and not only governments, but independent scientists, independent thinkers, you know, scientists working for different institutions, academic, government, pharmaceutical companies, and all. You know, so there has to be this agreement by all these leading scientists, you know, which in all the world, across the world, globally, you know. But you will see that most of these conspiracies, you know, it's videos, and you follow the people behind the conspiracies. It's not people who really, I can say, are in the main scientific frontline scientific research as such, you know. So we have to really be very careful with the conspiracies. Anything good will be struck down, you know. In fact, I knew that the moment vaccines, an announcement is made about vaccines, these conspiracies will start coming up. Today, I even heard a conspiracy about those swabs that we use for collecting samples in the nasopharyngeal swabs for collecting samples for COVID tests. Someone says, no, there are something that they put to enter our brains to control us. You know? So I always wonder and marvel at the imagination that is out there. So really...
Okay, Dr.
So, yeah, I can keep going on and on.
Yeah,
let me go to the next person.
Okay, the second question. So we have three questions already. So they are posted on the chat. Could you please, the second question, could you please elaborate on the allergic reaction we've heard about in the participants? Would these be typical of the ordinary person in the community? So that's the second question.
Okay, yeah, so, you know, allergic reactions is one of the side effects. It causes mild allergic-like reactions. Now, during the clinical trials, people with allergies were excluded, you know, from the clinical trial. So really that was not extensively studied regarding, you know, the effect. So when these, this was reported in the patients in the UK where they had some serious allergic reactions. But again, those controlled, you know, they were controlled, you know, and were treated. So, and now we know, you know, the thing about these vaccines again is whatever happens, whatever ill effect happens, you know, it's observed. So it's not like people are treated and are given vaccines, then they're left on their own. So, you know, but for someone without an allergic, without allergies, it's unlikely that they will react to this in the way these patients reacted.
All right.
But it's something
happens.
Now, the next question, how long will immunity last once one has been vaccinated? We don't know. It's a new vaccine. We know that it's very effective. How long the immunity is going to last, we're not sure, but that's the knowledge that will be gained as time goes. And we hope it's long-lasting immunity, but it's still possible that it may even turn out to be like the flu vaccine, where every year people have to be vaccinated, but we hope it doesn't happen that way. There was a question about Mzungus.
Yeah, well, the Africans...
So is it true that Africans and people of color will get a different vaccine? No, this is the same vaccine, actually. Yeah, so no differentiation. Even in the clinical trials, there were some black people, though that was underrepresented. But yeah, there were black people, and it will be the same vaccine. Maybe the only difference... will be that, like the Pfizer vaccine, it has to be stored under minus 70 degrees. So for some countries, say in Africa, that would be quite challenging. So they may end up getting a different vaccine by another company that is easier to transport and store, like Moderna. You know, but it's not because it was designed for Africans or white people. No, it's all the same.
Brother Mandel's hand has been up for a long time.
Whose hand?
Brother Manda, William Manda.
Oh, okay. So, go ahead.
Yeah, so maybe let me just touch the issue of blacks and you know how many were part of the studies. I'm not sure the exact number, but I know that it was underrepresented. It's unfortunate that most of the times when it comes to vaccine, I think when we are following this, you, for example, heard how people would protest when there was any suggestion that the vaccines were going to be tested in black people. They'll say, why in black people? You know, so there's still that, you know, thing. But so black populations ended up being underrepresented. Okay. But that does not mean that these vaccines will not work in black people. They will work, okay? And but it would have been good, really, to have that full representation. Just like pregnant women were excluded because we know the risks. So we don't know how it will work. Young people again were excluded, so we don't know whether the vaccines will work too well in young people. You know, so those are some of the limitations.
All right, Brother Whitman. Did I hear somebody say something? Oh,
thank you very much. Part of my question was answered when Mazulu said the vaccine will probably have to be given every year. Because my question was, like here in Illinois, we have a lot of people having COVID and whatnot. So my issue was, if you've had COVID, are you supposed to be vaccinated or do you have an immune system? So now when I heard him say, like probably to be like the flu vaccine, if I heard him correctly, you have to get it almost every year. Is that true?
Yeah, so really the question, the answer is we don't know.
Oh, okay.
How long this immunity will last. It may last a short period, but long lasting is something that will be studied after the vaccinations now. So as I said, if it doesn't last long, then it will end up being like a flu shot where every year it has been. But if it lasts long, then you don't have to repeat the vaccination.
And the second part is somebody has had COVID or they have COVID, do they have immune or do they still need to take the vaccine? That's my last question.
Yeah, so the immunity due to COVID, yes, there is some immunity. And it's known that if someone has had COVID, the immunity is there, and but it does wane. And the reinfection has been known, though it's not that common, but people have been reinfected even after having COVID. Yeah, but there is some immunity. In fact, that's how immunotherapy has been developed, where people who have had COVID donate their plasma, and then it's used to develop all these immunotherapies because of that immunity.
Okay, thank you. There's a hand. Perhaps I'll just say if you're tired, if you feel like tired, just feel free to log out. Brother Chris has his hand up. So thank you again for the fellowship, and thank you for the participants, and thanks for coming. So Brother Chris.
I've observed that since all this is happening, well, before, there is zero information on nutrition and your immune system through natural therapy. Not just on this COVID, but on almost all sickness. And I'm not necessarily curious to know, but while it is illegal to push natural remedies as a cure in the US, why are the people not talking about nutrition, building your immune system? Because when the virus has passed, your mask and your washing of hands, your only defense that is left is your immune system. So why is it that there's no talk of it? And two, I thought I read that Pfizer said that the 95% is to suppress symptoms and not to prevent infection.
Okay, let me start with the last part, 95%. It's not to suppress symptoms, it's to boost immunity, to induce an immune response. So that, and these are people who are healthy, who haven't had COVID. So when they're given this vaccine, they develop an immune response, which is protective against infections, okay? And then 100% of those who are vaccinated, none developed a severe infection, okay? So which means the immunity is so strong that it even if someone developed some kind of, it doesn't progress to severe illness, but 95% protective. Now, regarding natural immunity, you know, God created us with natural immunities. You know, we, in fact, our immune system is so strong, so robust, that if we keep healthy, we eat right, we exercise, you know, the immunity is strong and will protect us from many, many illnesses, okay? A good example, even the COVID itself, you've seen that among young people who are still active, no underlying conditions, they are robust, you know, their immunity is able to contain the virus. But it's not 100%. That's how you still have had people becoming sick. And some, even if they don't become sick, they are carriers, they are asymptomatic, they are infected and asymptomatic. And they do transmit the virus. Now, what the vaccination does is that we are introduced ahead of the infections to something that induces an immune response, so that the moment the infection comes, immediately the body is sensitized already to produce an immune system. So it's using also the natural abilities of the body to respond, except that it has been sensitized already. You know, so and the better and the stronger your health, I mean, in terms of nutrition, exercise, and all, the stronger the immune response, so the better protected you will be. Let me also go on further to say that sometimes in the argument about nutrition, natural immunity, it may sound as if we are going against the what God has naturally built in us, but it's not really going against what God has done. You know, let me take you back, give an example of illnesses we have had in the past. We used to have measles. We used to have polio and all those things. We had natural immunities, but, you know, those viruses would break through. Now, with vaccines, we don't cure those illnesses anymore. And that's the knowledge God has given us, be able to produce vaccines against all these measles, smallpox, which is not there anymore. So it's knowledge God has given us that we can use to protect humanity.
Dr. Zudo, I've talked to you about this. A few weeks ago, I was in a Zoom meeting with Levi Mwanawasa Medical University doctors, and they were explaining a very strange phenomena in Zambia, the patterns of infections. So in the Shanti compounds and rural Zambia, the infections are very low, and it's largely in Kabulonga. It's with the wealthy and the educated. Could you explain the Zambian phenomena?
Okay, so yeah, so that's something that we're seeing in most countries in Africa, actually, and it's not known exactly why. In fact, there are a lot of reasons why the COVID in Africa hasn't taken root, and some of the factors are exactly what you've explained. You know, we know, like here, that underlying medical conditions, obesity, hypertension, diabetes, all those have made the situation worse. Now, the Kabulonga that you talked about, for those who may not know Kabulonga, that's an affluent society in Zambia. And sometimes the pattern of illnesses is similar, you know, people are overweight, sometimes they have hypertension, they have others. So you tend to get similar effects. But in what we call the poorer areas, you know, people, their diet is basic, but most of the time that basic diet is the best diet, actually. You know, they walk as opposed to driving. You know, they're naturally exercising all the time. You look at their body mass index, is within the normal. So that's a population similar probably to the young people here, where you hear that all young people don't easily get infected. So, and then the demographics of Zambia and Africa is that the majority, about 60%, are young people. You know, so there's that natural protection against COVID that we haven't seen here. There are fewer older people, you know. So all those are theories as to why Africa has been protected. And of course, one thing that I keep talking about is how probably the preparedness of Africa, as opposed to here, we've been dealing with epidemics all the time. And clearly, as we are studying this, we see that the preparedness against one epidemic can easily be switched to combat another epidemic. So probably the response has been better. Look at when you talk of contact tracing, is something that is done all the time and more effectively than we've seen in the developed world. So it's multifactorial, and but it's something that is being studied more to understand why COVID in Africa hasn't been taken root as it has.
Thank you all. Thank you, Brother Zulu. Good night.
Oh, I had one more question.